town. We're happy to be here. Playing for half the door and maybe a few beers. Here's an idea before this whole night goes south.
Al Floss presents the complete and alarming history of America's greatest garage band, The Stools.
The history of rock has tons of feel-good stories, some that are even half true, but the real story of rock doesn't often have happy endings. And if the tale of Emitt Rhodes doesn't break your heart, well, then you have no heart and should go get a job in middle management at a record company or in radio.
Emitt Rhodes got his start as a drummer for the Emeralds. Not the Emeralds, Emeralds, with no D. Because, well, it was the 60s. In 1964, even though they were just 15-year-old kids and they didn't have a record deal or anything like that, the band broke up over a contract dispute. Talk about foreshadowing.
A committed Anglophile, young Emitt Rhodes, and a couple of the Emeralds joined up with three Canadian brothers and called themselves the Palace Guard. I mean, complete with red British Guardsman uniforms. Casey Kasem invited them to play on his local TV show, Shebang. And they made their recording debut backing up the guy who played Robbie on My Three Sons on a single and then cut a couple of singles themselves.
The Palace Guard became the house band at the Hullabaloo on Sunset Strip, a big step up for a local band. Emitt was still on drums at this point, but they'd let him come out, you know, every once in a while to sing a cover of the Beatles' Michelle.
Russ Shaw, son of music publisher Eddie Shaw, saw potential in Emitt and signed him to a management deal. Russ Shaw was just a gopher at A&M Records at the time, but he talked a good game. He also got the teenaged Emitt to sign a publishing deal with his dad in perpetuity. I don't even know what that means. I can't imagine a teenager would know what that means.
Elvin Anderson from the Stools caught the Palace Guard one night, struck up a friendship with Emitt Rhodes, and invited him to come down to Golden Studios where the band was recording the next morning.
The resulting single was Bums in Seats. My favorite song from that period because it positively drips with contempt for the band's fans and even their drummer, who in this case was Emitt Rhodes.
You got to be what you are. It may not be the star. Those who play drums stuff too. Even if that's all you do. If it puts bums in the seats, we're counting up the receipts. Just sit there. Just sit there. You might have come for a show. There's something you should know. We're just up here watching you. Can't wait till we're through. You're just bums in the seats. Hey, you guys got to eat. Just sit there. Just sit there.
Well, the Stools may have invited Emitt Rhodes to join the band as drummer, but Emitt wasn't interested. He had other plans.
I'll tell you one more time. Why are you waiting in line? It's not like we're unique. Guitar players got no technique. To us, your jam's bumps in the seats. Keeping us off the streets. Just sit there. Just sit there.
Around this time, 1966, Emitt taught himself to play the guitar because it was easier to carry around. And he left the Palace Guard to start his Beatle-inspired four-piece, the Merry-Go-Round. Well, they were just another California garage band until former grassroots drummer Joel Larson and the Leeds bassist Bill Reinhardt were brought into the group. With a tighter rhythm section, they were ready to record their first demo, the song Live, which quickly became a hit.
The Bangles recorded a cover version of the song Live on their debut album years later and put it on two of their greatest hit albums, but Rhodes had never seen a dime of that money because the Shaws screwed him out of all of his publishing.
Of course, because it was a local hit, their label A&M wanted to rush a full album out quickly, so they just took a bunch of the band's demos, strung them together on one album, regardless of the quality.
Emitt Rhodes was a cute kid, Paul McCartney cute. When he was in Merry-Go-Round, he got booked as a contestant on the dating game.
Merry-Go-Round had another local hit, You're a Very Lovely Woman, but the older members of the band were getting a little tired of being bossed around by a teenage kid, which Emitt was at the time. And after 2 years, Merry-Go-Round broke up.
Fed up with the dynamic that having a band creates, no doubt compounded by time he spent hanging out with the Stools, Emitt Rhodes figured he'd be better off on his own. And he set up a 4-track recording studio in his parents' house that would allow him complete control over his artistic vision. And he took 4 instrumental backing tracks that he had been working on, mind you, instrumental tracks with no vocals, and he took them to ABC Dunhill Records. And then on the strength of those demos, they signed him to a deal. Well, they gave him $5,000 up front, which he quickly spent on more recording equipment.
Emitt Rhodes' first solo album on Dunhill was great. One of the engineers on it, Keith Olsen, would go on to produce Fleetwood Mac's Rumors. But Emitt's album sounded like lost tapes from the Beatles' White Album sessions. It was that good. But that's also what might have killed it. Some DJs started claiming it really was the Beatles, and then people started dismissing the whole thing as a joke.
When Merry-Go-Round broke up, they still owed A&M Records one more album on their deal, so Rhodes quickly went into the studio with some session guys and finished off a throwaway album of old Merry-Go-Round half-finished songs and turned it in. A&M didn't like it, and just put it on the shelf with no intention of releasing it. Then, when Rhodes' solo album with Dunhill started climbing on the charts, A&M smelt blood in the water and released the Merry-Go-Round album as Emitt Rhodes' solo album, totally confusing the fans, because they'd go into the record store looking for the new Emitt Rhodes album they had heard on the radio and wouldn't have any idea which was which.
The competing solo albums wasn't the last time the record company greed would bite him in the ass. 6 months after Rhodes' proper solo album came out on ABC Dunhill, they sued him because he hadn't provided the next album within 6 months, as his contract stated.
Dunhill was run by Jay Lasker, this wall-eyed, flounder-looking turd who had been an insurance salesman before his brother-in-law got him the job running Dunhill. Well, this will give you a good idea of how Jay Lasker ran his business. When ABC bought Dunhill, Lasker negotiated his contract to read that he get paid in units shipped, not units sold. So he would ship as many units as he could out to the stores, making a killing whether they sold or not.
The kid Rhodes had signed a contract with Dunhill that said he'd deliver a new album every 6 months. Now, back in the days of the crooner, recording other people's songs with an arranger, producer, and a conductor running everything, that wasn't a problem. But this was the dawn of the age of the singer-songwriter. Add to the fact that Rhodes played all the instruments, well...
No longer working in his parents' garage, but a proper studio, had a negative effect on Emitt Rhodes' output. Now, he could take his time and play with all the limiters, the compressors, and all the other bells and whistles and toys in the studio, and it took him over a year to finish his second Dunhill album.
The Beatles turned out 2 albums a year in their early days, but there was 4 of them and George Martin. Emitt Rhodes was all alone.
While the second solo album was another great album from Emitt, it seems Dunhill was more interested in suing him for taking so long rather than promoting the album, and it didn't sell very well.
Rhodes' third solo album had a more polished production sound to it, and being the 70s, was almost drowning in saxophone. It failed to chart, perhaps because there was very little to distinguish it from all the other product out there that the record companies were actually promoting.
And of course, he took too long recording the third album, and Dunhill sued him again. This time, for more money than he actually made from them in the first place. He just totally shut down. Stopped writing, recording, playing. At age 24, he had already burnt out.
Al Floss got Emmett Rhodes a job as a staff engineer at Electric Asylum Records, and he seemed to be happy living in obscurity while Bob Dylan, the Eagles, and Joni Mitchell enjoyed their time in the sun at the studio.
Rhodes had a huge backlog of ideas and tried to put out another solo album on the Rocktopia label in 2000, but that all fell apart when the label got into some financial trouble.
Every kid that's sitting in their bedroom in their parents' house recording their own songs on their own computer or whatever, oh, a big tip of the hat to Emmett Rhodes. Go track down his stuff and buy it. Don't just steal it from the internet.
Some critics dismiss Emmett Rhodes, saying he was a Paul McCartney ripoff. But really, he's the Paul McCartney we all wish Paul McCartney would have been. Rhodes had all of Sir Paul's pop sensibilities without all the sticky sentimentality or cute coyness, you know?
According to the internet, and we know how reliable that can be, Emmett recorded one more song with the Stools in the late 70s, called Your Wife Says. It was kind of an ode to the Beatles, so it's fitting that Rhodes is in on it.
So you broke up the band and started something new. Side by side with your bride, the way some fellas do. It didn't work out so well, so you brought in some old friends. But the mix just can't fix wives and girlfriends. Just say no, 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 no. You're not only one to blame, Johnny did it too. A brand new start, making art, 'cause that's what she's into. No one says it's not your right to make records with who you want. But for Christ's sake, give us a break from the idiot to your savant. Just say no, 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 no.
The story of Emmett Rhodes is a sad one, but that kind of thing happened a lot. For example, back in 1959, record companies were using a shotgun approach to move records. You know, just throw it against the wall and see what happens. If one act sticks, then you ride that one and leave the others behind. That's what happened to another one of the Stools' friends, Gene Maltias.
Yeah, Gene Maltias was this kid kicking around New Hampshire, singing along with the jukebox, and everyone told him how great he was and that he should go to Nashville. So he just packs up and he does just that.
Maltias drives his 49 Chevy down to Nashville, sleeps in the back of the car, does odd jobs to stay alive. Now, what set Gene Maltias apart from the pack was that he was writing his own songs, and they were good. Chet Atkins sees this and hooks Gene up with the great Webb Pierce.
Webb Pierce is doing this Brenda Lee session in the spring of 1957 over at the Bradley Studios. And they got a little time left over at the end, so they stick Gene Maltias in there to cut a couple of sides, Crazy Baby and Gang War.
The best thing about Gene Maltias was hearing him sing rockabilly with that New England accent. You know, the cop-cop merger? It wasn't a gang war, it was a gang wah.
Now, Decca, of course, had other irons in the fire. They were working the Flamingos, Bill Ward and the Dominoes, Bobby Helms, Patsy Cline, Red Foley. Plus, they were so messed up, they didn't even know they had Buddy Holly signed to three different labels. So it was easy to fall between the cracks in those days.
Crazy Baby and Gang War, those are two great songs by Maltias. Now, because Crazy Baby was recorded on the ass end of a Brenda Lee session, it's got Hank Garland and Owen Bradley playing guitar and piano on it. Pretty high cotton.
Can you imagine getting Hank Garland on your very first record? He was the session guy that Elvis, Johnny Cash, and Patsy Cline all turned to. He was the Nashville A-Team, until his crazy-ass wife twisted him all up. But of course, that's a story for another time. We're talking about the tragedy of Gene Maltias.
So, even with these great session guys, Maltias' Crazy Baby fails to do much, and Gene decides to head out and try the West Coast. Johnny and Jackie cover a couple of his songs for Aladdin Records, but he doesn't have much luck out there either, so he returns to New Hampshire.
Maltias did a session for Regal Records when he was in LA, and he claims Duane Eddy was playing the lead guitar on it. But the record never did much, and Eddy was still in Arizona at the time. So he might have been thinking about Casey, the session guy that wrote Ramrod for Duane Eddy. You know how stories get started.
Gene Maltias was never the brightest bulb in the drawer. He couldn't even grasp the basics of payola. A DJ once told him that he would play his song for a couple of sawbucks. Well, Gene thought that meant not only would he play the record, he'd give Gene 20 bucks for letting him do it. Strictly Four Corners.
Gene Maltias is one of those many stories in rock where the guy has great talent, but never catches the lucky break. Of course, he didn't do a whole lot to help himself out either.
Well, Link Wray's Rumble, which is an instrumental, was being banned by radio stations because they were afraid of what it might drive the kids to do. And here comes Maltias with a song called Gang War, with lyrics about blood and thunder and whacking a kid in the head with a pipe. New Hampshire, where Maltias is from, is the state that has Live Free or Die on its license plates. I mean, now we think of them as just a bunch of gun nuts. But back then, in the 50s, they were a kind of a breed apart. Maltias never signed any of the record contracts that were offered him because his daddy told him to never sign his name to a piece of paper. That couldn't have gone over too well with Decca Records.
It probably didn't help that he was hanging out with Elvin Anderson when he first hit Nashville. Because Maltias had been brought in by Webb Pierce, Decca gave him the all-star treatment. Paul Cohen, who was Webb's producer, gave Maltias 50 bucks to get a nice hotel room and a meal for the night so he'd be rested for the recording in the morning. Elvin takes him out and drinks up $49 of it and spends the last buck on a room at the Y so they can crash for an hour.
They cut Crazy Baby, which is a rockin' tune, but Owen Bradley, being Owen Bradley and hating rock and roll, wants them to cut a ballad for the B-side. So Maltias goes into his best crying Johnny Ray impression, and it sucks. But they keep at it, and after about 8 takes, Gene is spent. I mean, cut the guy a break. He's still hungover from the night before, so Elvin takes him aside, hands him a bottle of Karo syrup, you know, that corn syrup sugary crap they give to constipated babies. Well, it does the trick. Gene knocks the song out of the park. You know, this was the days before anyone knew about cocaine. Except for bus drivers. And who's hanging out with bus drivers?
So they get through the session, and rather than hang around and wait for the single to come out, Elvin talks Gene into heading out to LA. Somewhere around Philly, they run out of money, so Gene, bold as you please, walks into Bill Haley in the Comet's management office and tells them he has a single coming out on Decca, is in a little bit of a pinch money-wise, and he'd like to write a song for Bill. They give him 25 bucks, Gene says, he'll be right back with the song. But he and Elvin just continued right along to LA. Never did write the song for Haley.
There are endless stories about Gene and Elvin in Nashville and beyond. You know, something about stealing Connie Francis from Bobby Darin, and then there's the story about them, you know, making fun of a song Maltias was trying to sell to Webb Pierce, and things got a little physical, and someone hits Tillis in the head with a 2x4, and that's where a stutter came from. But again, the history of music is littered with these stories. I do know the Stools song, Prison Shower Blues, comes from, you know, the night of partying between Maltias and Elvin Anderson.
I went out on a Saturday,
stain, spending up my per diem. Just another innocent dude with a prison shower blue. We hooked up with the Sisters Act we'd seen before. Ended up in a suicide pact, at least that's what we swore. But when it came time to lay, turns out I was fast asleep, waking up the accused with the prison shower blue. You know the joke about the soap. You know that joke is true. Don't provoke the pig in the poke. Oh, that joke be on you.
Basically, Decca dumped Gene Maltese's record and put all their promo weight behind the young Buddy Holly. Bye bye Gene, hello Peggy Sue. Story as old as rock itself. And we'll be telling even more of these stories as the complete and alarming history of America's greatest garage band, The Stools, continues next time. Join us then, won't you?
Seems the cops take the dim view, the guys in bands. We were just passing through. I'm sure you'll understand. Staring at for sale walls in the basement of some town hall. Trade the laces off my shoes for these prison shower blues.